This week on the Brody File, we're in Colorado and we're hunting for drones in the town of Deer Trail. One man's mission against the government.
In 5 years, the skies are going to be black with these things. There's going to be millions of them.
Also, Colorado talks secession. Could we be looking at a 51st state called North Colorado?
We're at this point of irreconcilable differences. It's predominantly left versus right, but it's urban versus rural.
And a sports ministry in Colorado that puts Jesus in the middle.
We're called to meet people outside of the walls of the church and in our community. And sports is one of the best ways.
It's one of the most beautiful states in the entire country. The Brody File, on the road in Colorado, next.
And welcome, everybody, to another edition of the Brody File. We are on the road again, this time in beautiful Colorado. We're actually coming to you from Dillon, Colorado, a couple hours west into the mountains from Denver. You know, the last time we were here, remember the Christmas show? Of course, we were sledding. We were snowmobiling. What am I talking about? Remember the crew, Mark and Matt and Tracy and all of us? We had a great time, but we have come to safer ground here in Dillon, Colorado. Now, look, there are a lot of interesting political stories going on here in this state. One of them has to do with the S word, secession. That's right. What we're talking about here is the 51st State Initiative. There are folks here in Colorado that basically want to secede, get away from, start their whole new state. They are tired of liberal lawmakers in Denver, Colorado, dictating things. And so many of the rural counties here have had enough, and now those type of measures are on the ballot. Will they succeed? Have a look. The United States of America, comprised of 50 states. But wait a minute, what if the map looked like this? A 51st state called Jefferson, made up of Northern California and Southern Oregon. Or how about a new state called Western Maryland or North Colorado? These are real movements gaining traction with voters.
We're at this point of irreconcilable differences.
Jeffrey Hare runs the 51st State Initiative in Colorado, an effort to fight an out-of-control legislature trying to ram big government policies down the throats of voters. It's so the talk of town hall meetings.
I have seen changes happen, particularly over the last 10 to 15 years in this state, that concern me.
It's predominantly left versus right, but it's urban versus rural because you typically find more traditional conservative values in rural America.
And that's the crux of the issue. Rural Americans across many states feel they're just not being heard. Their laundry list is long, and at the top, gun control laws.
They are out of touch with rural Colorado. There is an attack on rural Colorado, and it's not just with the gun control laws, it's on several of the other bills that they passed.
Indeed it is. The government mandates cover renewable energy, environmental policies that restrict oil and gas drilling, and controversial social issues like gay marriage. Organizers want to create North Colorado, and that idea went to voters in 11 counties this past fall.
I don't think that that's necessarily the way to make something happen within the area that you live. You're supposed to work within our electoral services.
The so-called secession movement here in Colorado had mixed results this past November. Some counties approved it, others didn't. But the organizers of the 51st State Initiative say, hold on a moment, this type of movement takes time.
Movements take a while. Education takes time. People have people do have a hard time saying, I want to live in a different state, even though they physically live in the same house. Mm-hmm. It's hard for them, since their lives have been Coloradoans their whole lives, to say that I'm going to be a new Coloradoan or I want to live in the state of liberty or something different.
That desire for something different can also be felt in states like Arizona, Michigan, and in Western Maryland, where thousands have signed secession petitions. One website reads, quote, "We intend to exercise our right of self-determination and self-governance to better secure our rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness."
If they're not going to listen or take our needs into consideration and govern in a way that's more in accordance with how we wish to be governed, we are seeking an amicable divorce.
In Northern California and Southern Oregon, activists want to come together in the state of Jefferson. Their proposed state flag includes two X's, representing their feeling of being double-crossed by the state capitals of Sacramento and Salem.
We need signatures. We need boots on the ground of people that want to go out into your neighborhoods, your churches, your jobs, wherever you're at, and explain this to people and get signatures of support.
Creating a new state isn't easy. As a matter of fact, the last time a state actually gave up territory was in 1820 when Maine split from Massachusetts. Since then, additional efforts have been unsuccessful. The first step is getting it passed by the state legislature and then on to the U.S. Congress.
This is a valid constitutional process that our founding fathers specifically wrote in the Constitution. Well, if they didn't write it into the Constitution to be used, then why did they write it in?
But supporters have an uphill battle. The media will not be their friend.
The danger is that once the outside media starts to grab hold of it, the attention is on the difficulty, the almost impossibility of it happening.
State secession proponents will keep fighting because they say the dismissive attitude of state legislative bodies must end.
I find the sort of arrogant dismissive to be further proof as to just how disconnected the urban is from the rural.
Movements like this in Colorado and other states could be just the beginning.
This isn't a Well County problem. This is a national problem.
It's called voter discontent, where the people say they've had enough and they're crying out for something to be done.
We at some point have to figure out a way to get our point across, or at least to be able to have a dialogue and not be ignored. Because if you haven't seen anything yet over the next 5 to 10 years.
I think ultimately people want, whether you look at it from a right or left paradigm, is people want government to stay out of their business.
You know, the state of Colorado really has gone from a very conservative state to more of a purple state. Some would even say very much a liberal state. You know, one of the reasons they're saying that is for measures like this, recreational marijuana, now legal in Colorado. That's right. In January, that's when it became legal. Voters approved it here in Colorado. It's kind of a libertarian thing, but also somewhat of a liberal thing. A lot of Californians actually coming out to Colorado and having a say in Colorado politics. It doesn't make everybody happy. But indeed, now you can go to a store and purchase marijuana for recreational use.
My personal views aside, my job now is to carry forth the regulatory framework and the enforcement mechanisms of this industry in a very responsible and professional manner.
Brain development is really rapidly occurring from about age 10 well into our mid to late 20s. Your brain's kind of under construction, and it disrupts the development of circuits. And the latest study shows that regular use when you're an adolescent is associated with a 6 to 8 point reduction in IQ.
Well, that gives a whole nother meaning to the same Rocky Mountain High, and a lot of folks are not happy about it. All right, when we come back, the church lady going undercover. All right, she's not undercover, but she's got a great story about sports groups and Jesus Christ along the Front Range of Colorado, witnessing for Christ when we come back.
Hi, my name is Breda. I'm just your typical 9-year-old. I love singing, dancing, reading, discovering the simple truth. My grandpa says you're never too young or old to learn the value of a dollar. He taught me the true value of this paper doll. You see this little gold coin? It says $1 on it. But guess what? That was a long time ago. Today, this gold dollar is worth over 100 paper dollars. This paper dollar is now only worth 1 penny compared to America's former money, the gold dollar. My grandpa says the only money worth saving today is real money, gold or silver coins. He's pretty smart. How our paper dollars lost their value, he says. It's all explained in a new book, The Great Debasement. It's easy and fun to read. If you call the number on the screen, I will send you a copy totally free. Next time, I'll explain the simple truth about money.
Millions of Americans with an ostomy live their lives to the fullest every day. And over the last 10 years, thousands have chosen Liberator Medical as their caring and reliable resource for ostomy supplies. Liberator Medical is a nationally accredited Medicare, Medicaid, and insurance provider, so we can handle all your Medicare, Medicaid, and insurance paperwork and billing. And Liberator Medical has been chosen as a preferred supplier by all the leading ostomy manufacturers, including Coloplast, Hollister, ConvaTec, and Generics. We supply all these leading ostomy brands so you can always get the ostomy supplies and accessories you want and trust. And all of our ostomy care specialists are product certified by the manufacturers. Shipping is free and discreetly delivered right to your door. Unhappy with your present ostomy supplier? Call Liberator Medical and ask about our free ostomy sampling program. We also offer catheters and urological supplies. Call 1-800-513-3076. That's 1-800-513-3076.
And welcome back, everybody, to our Colorado show, the Brody File on the road from Dillon, Colorado, about 2 hours west of Denver. The church lady on the case here in Colorado, we brought her along, you know her, Tracy Winborn. She takes a look now at the Red Rocks Ministry, really interesting, about how they're affecting lives for Jesus Christ, and it all happens through sports.
Let's have us all have a good weekend.
Amen.
Scott Russomano's vision of a full-scale sports ministry began 8 years ago at Red Rocks Church in Denver, Colorado. Shortly after approaching his pastor with the idea, a volleyball league was born, and the Red Rocks Sports Ministry blossomed from there. Russomano seemed to connect better with people through sports, and he thought, what better way to reach out to those not interested in going to church?
We're called to meet people outside of the walls of the church and in our community. And sports is one of the best ways of connecting with people, like I said, in a non-threatening way.
Red Rock Sports Ministry now has year-round leagues ranging from dodgeball to baseball and everything in between. Jenny Vieira played sports in college, and after she graduated, she had a hard time maintaining a healthy lifestyle and finding a new church. The Red Rocks Bowling League helped her do both.
When I found a church that would help me grow in my faith, but I could also kind of fellowship with people and find new communities through sports, it was like the perfect combination for me.
Volunteer Jeremy Coleman found it helped him connect with other Christians.
I was going to Red Rocks for close to 2 years. I sat in the second row in the same spot every time and never really got to know anyone. So when I found out about the bowling league, I knew I needed more Christian community in my life, and that was easy. For me to feel like I can meet people in a non-scary, non-evasive way.
The Red Rock Sports Ministry here in Colorado has really made an impact when it comes to affecting lives for Jesus Christ. Thousands have signed up to take part in these sports groups because organizers believe it's not just important to make sure you're physically fit, but spiritually fit as well.
There's just so many opportunities to, have fun while working out. Because I think that's the hardest thing nowadays is, people are just, they don't want that ho-hum, like that 35 minutes on a treadmill, you get bored. But this way you meet new people, there's fellowship, you're building community, and you're still getting a good workout.
One way these leagues help build community, people pray after the games, not before. It helps cut down on unsportsmanlike conduct, even though players admit there's nothing wrong with a little healthy competition.
I just know I've met so many people that have really struggled building a community that aren't Christian, that I'll invite to come on the basketball team, and they're captivated by the fact that we pray afterwards with these people that are our competitors, our opponents that we just went to war with in these games, and we're able to put that all aside and come back at the end.
We try to bring everybody together at the end of the game, hopefully to humble their hearts a little bit, to show appreciation for the fact that they're getting to play a sport, and kind of lessen those emotions a little bit so we can leave the court or the field just being friends again.
Maintaining Christ-like friendships between opposing teams may be one goal, but another is keeping their leagues at a high skill level. They even hold a draft.
And the goal with that is that you're kind of taken out of your comfort zone. You have to meet new people. You're forced out of your circle of friends. And then what we've seen is the culture of our sports community has been great, because the following season, now all of a sudden you're drafted onto a new team, and now you're playing against those friends that you played with the season before. And so it's just created a really nice environment for our players.
Red Rock Sports Ministry has grown beyond the church walls and into many parts of the community. Russomano says they are called to fill the void in the hearts of people who need it most.
We work with orphanages, we work with homeless people, we work with people with disabilities, and we just want to get involved. And as a church, we want to bless the community. It's so many stories that we hear where they credit being introduced to the church through the sports ministry, being introduced to their new community of friends, and then ultimately giving their life to the Lord, and then beyond that, getting baptized.
And Russomano wants to challenge other pastors. He says, believe in what a sports ministry can do and watch your church grow. Tracy Winborn, CBN News, Denver, Colorado.
The church lady on the case here in Colorado. All right, when we come back, one-on-one with Sheriff Cook in Weld County, Colorado. He's not going to enforce some of these stricter gun laws.
Why, you say? The answer next.
Attention, sleep apnea patients. Are you tired of the expense and hassle of getting your CPAP and BiPAP supplies? Are you fed up with dealing with ill-fitting, leaking, or worn-out masks and straps? Are you worried about the effects that unsanitary tubes, cushions, and filters have on your health? If you said yes to any of these questions, Allied Medical Supply Network has the solution to your problems. You could qualify to have your supplies regularly delivered right to your door at little or no cost to you. That's right, no more inconvenience, no worn-out masks and straps, no more unsanitary equipment, just restful sleep. Call Allied Medical Supply Network today to determine if you may qualify to receive your fresh, brand-name supplies at little or no cost. Don't delay. Call us now to see if you are eligible to save money on regular delivery of your CPAP and BiPAP supplies. Call 1-800-815-9947. That's 1-800-815-9947. Or go to CPAPSupplyHelpline.com.
And welcome back, everybody, to beautiful Dillon, Colorado. Does it get any better than this in the mountains here? Sun is shining, reflector in my face, but the mountains behind me are just absolutely beautiful. Sheriff John Cook, remember the name. He is not going to enforce any Colorado gun control laws that have been passed by the liberal state legislature here in Denver. He's one of 55 sheriffs who say, no dice, not going to do it. He believes that they're just, in essence, unenforceable. He believes that the legislature has gone too far. Here's some of our conversation with the man from Weld County, Colorado.
The state legislature passed some gun control laws earlier this year, and they did it in such a way that they didn't really want any input. They had an agenda, and so the sheriffs, we had about 30 of the sheriffs, went down and testified at the Capitol, or tried to testify, about the gun control bills, because what they were doing, it was a knee-jerk reaction to the Aurora shooting and then the Newtown shooting last year, and so they felt like they had to do something. And what they did is they said, well, we're legislators, we have to give the impression we're going to do something about it. So they came up with these horrible, unenforceable, vague laws on gun control. Jesus Christ himself could have come down from heaven and testified against these bills, and they still would have passed them, because they had an agenda and they didn't care about them. So we as sheriffs and said, well, look, we're going to sue the state of Colorado against these gun control bills, because we feel they're unconstitutional. That's our opinion. They're unconstitutional and they're unenforceable. And so it's not only a Second Amendment violation, we believe, but a 14th Amendment violation. Well, I also said that I wouldn't enforce them when they passed the gun control laws. I said, you know, they're unenforceable, so therefore I'm not going to enforce them. Being the chief law enforcement officer, it's all about priorities.
That is Sheriff John Cook here on the Brody File. All right, we are going to go about 3 hours from here, from Dillon, Colorado, the beautiful mountains, to the eastern plains of Colorado, Deer Trail, Colorado. Oh boy, wait till you meet Phil Steele. If you're flying a drone over his house, take it down, or else he will. Back in a moment.
Announcing an important breakthrough in healthcare that can benefit everyone. If you or anyone you love needs affordable health insurance, regardless of a pre-existing medical condition, call Quick Insurance 123 today and get the immediate relief you deserve. Quick Insurance 123 was created to provide affordable health insurance to all uninsured Americans, with or without pre-existing conditions. This is not a discount card. This is a real insurance program that lets you choose from many affordable health plans, with access to doctors, hospitals, emergency services, and more. So call the number on your screen now and get the health coverage you need, just for calling. As a special bonus, we'll send you a free prescription savings card that could save you up to 85% on your prescriptions. That's right, you could save up to 85% on your prescriptions, just for calling. Call Quick Insurance 123 to find out how you can get affordable health insurance and receive your free prescription savings card, just for calling. Don't wait. Getting a free quote is as easy as 123. Call today.
And welcome back, everybody, to Dillon, Colorado. You know, Keystone Ski Resort, 20 minutes away. Breckenridge, Colorado, about 30 minutes away. It is beautiful here in this part of the country. We now want to go 3 hours from here east to Deer Trail, Colorado. Small town, 500 people or so. The town is divided, and it's because of this guy, Phil Steele. He's been there for a while. He's come up with a town ordinance where he basically wants to shoot drones out of the sky if they come over the town of Deer Trail. Some folks in the town don't like it, others do, but either way, Phil is in the middle of a heap of controversy.
It's kind of over the top, it has a sight.
Phil Steele isn't playing around.
the bayonet.
He's locked and loaded and ready for some drone action in Deer Trail.
Well, that's why I call it Phil's treehouse.
He's even built a watchtower where he would be allowed to shoot down drones if his ordinance passed.
Signed by the mayor and me, the author of the ordinance.
Oh, and if the federal government didn't try and stop him.
The ordinance was written totally in the spirit of civil defense. Okay, so this could work well as a watchtower, for example. Well, I'd be looking for small unmanned aerial vehicles. They would come in a variety of different configurations. The ordinance sets forth a number of criteria for identifying one. It must be windowless, with no apparent means of entry or egress. It must be too small for human habitation, so it has to be obviously an unmanned aerial vehicle. It has to be flying under 1,000 feet. When gravity does the rest.
And when Phil came down from that watchtower, he showed us his souped up gun.
The shotgun red dot, green dot scope is really nice. I was actually able to successfully engage an Estes rocket at 600 feet with that. The other is a laser and tactical flashlight.
All right, so why is Phil doing this? Well, he says that while technology can be good, it's not in this case.
This is cyberspace, where cyberspace meets real space and time. The government is telling us that drones have many good and beneficial purposes. Wildfires, crops and livestock, all this. Tell you the reality though. The reality is a law was passed in 2012 that takes effect in September 2015, redefining navigable airspace as being that airspace which extends all the way down to the ground level across every square inch of America. In this country, we have the Interstate Commerce Clause of the U.S. Constitution. That means the federal government can only regulate things that affect interstate commerce. If navigable airspace, the airspace that airplanes fly through, extends all the way down to the ground, the federal government will be able to regulate every activity in human life.
And he goes on to say that these drones could have devious purposes.
In 5 years, the skies are going to be black with these things. There's going to be millions of them. And when there are millions, some of them will be used by drug dealers to deliver drugs. Others will be used by people for stalking, voyeurism, pedophiles, casing neighborhoods for burglaries.
Like, where does this end?
This creates crime with impunity.
Steele's plan is dividing the small town of Deer Trail. Sharon Morgan, who works at a local gas station, has concerns.
His whole plan is very well thought out. Mm-hmm. I just don't think it's right for Deer Trail.
Yeah, why is that?
Because we're not against the federal government. That's my money that's flying up in the air as a drone. That's everybody's money that's flying up there in the air as a drone. And it's here to help us with agriculture, how our crops grow, things like that. It's not here to spy on us. We're Deer Trail. Really? I mean, literally, we're Deer Trail. What is there to spy on?
Morgan says Steele's plan has at times made the town the butt of jokes.
A frustration for the town. There are some people who think it's important, and there are other people who think it's shed a very bad light on this town. It's kind of made us a joke. I mean, my brother called me from Albuquerque and asked me if I was building a bigger garage so that I could house all my cars so that they didn't get hit with the shotgun pellets that were gonna go up. And then he said, can you get me a drone license? And I said, I'll hang up on you about right now because I'm against it.
It's best to bend your knees.
But Steele, he's not gonna be deterred. He's carrying on.
This is asserting our right to the sovereignty of our town, our town and its citizens, and the sovereignty and supremacy of the airspace of the town.
Phil Steele here on the Brody File. All right, when we come back, a 6-year-old and sexual harassment?
Like a Vault, the OFA moment of the week from Colorado. In a moment.
Do you have an idea for an invention or a new product? Brian and Alice Jagosh, the inventors of the halftime drill driver, did. They invented a power drill attachment that lets you drill, flip, and drive in seconds. Brian and Alice licensed their invention to the company that brought you the Snuggie, and it's now selling in major retailers nationwide. Look for the Invent Help Caveman on the package. If you have an invention that you would like to try to patent and submit to companies for possible review and want free information on how InventHelp may be able to assist you, call now. InventHelp is America's largest inventor service company with sales offices in more than 60 cities nationwide. Call InventHelp today for free information. Our clients made a financial gain with their invention, but this is just their individual result. Brian and Alice's experience is not typical, as only a very small number of inventions are licensed or sold in stores.
For your free inventors information, call 1-800-559-8567. That's 1-800-559-8567.
If you had a choice between going bald and a full head of hair, which would you choose? Advances in medical science have resulted in the world's first and only permanent solution to hair loss.
Yes!
You wash it, you cut it. It's your own real naturally growing hair. When it comes to hair restoration, no one in the world has more experience than Bosley. The results look completely natural and are affordable on nearly any budget. But the entire process can't be explained in 60 brief seconds. So to find out more about this clinically proven and permanent solution to hair loss, call now to receive your free no-obligation information kit. It'll answer all of your questions about hair loss and hair restoration. Plus, we'll also send you this $250 gift certificate just for calling. Every day you wait, you're losing more hair. So don't put it off any longer. You owe it to yourself to find out the facts. Choose hair. Choose Bosley.
Call 800-868-9957. That's 800-868-9957.
And welcome back, everybody, to Dillon, Colorado, here on the Brody File. We are on the road once again. Time now for an Oy Vey moment of the week. And yes, recreational marijuana could be an Oy Vey. Gun control legislation run amok could be an Oy Vey. No, we've got a better one. Here it is. Well, I want you to meet 6-year-old Hunter. He goes to an elementary school in Canyon City, Colorado. That's about an hour or so west of Colorado Springs. Guess what, folks? He's got a record. That's right. This 6-year-old has a record of sexual harassment. Wait a minute. Hold on. Here's what he did. He kissed a girl on the cheek, or was it the hand? We're not quite sure. No one's quite exactly sure here, but here's his side of the story.
We're still in class, yeah. We were doing reading group, and I made no one kissed her on the hand. That's what happened.
The other children saw it and went to the music teacher. And that was the day that I had the meeting with the principal where she first said sexual harassment.
Now they are saying that instead of sexual harassment, it's now going to be called sexual misconduct. But either way, school officials say it's still on his record and will stay on his record. Roy Gavolt, are you kidding me? This is what it's come to. By the way, Hunter, if you have a record, you can't work for the Brody File. But hopefully it'll be cleared sometime soon. All right, that does it from beautiful Dillon, Colorado, the ski slopes of Colorado. Until next time, we'll see you in the stuffy old studio. Have a great week.